So basically what happens in a residential building type of activities, the structure, there are structural engineers who design the building structurally, and there is a construction engineer who construct that building as per the drawings issued by the design engineer, right? And he, the other aspects he doesn't see. But in a process industry, civil engineer who is involved with a large consultant, and only large consultant can do these process type of industries. They are, they employ thousands of engineers with them, and they do take up these EPC projects. There the civil engineer is designs the road and roads within that plants. He does the planning, design, that means the development of the plot plan. A major role is played by the civil engineer in plot plan, plot plan design. He is also looks after the soil engineering, geotech engineering. He looks after the architecture part. The architecture part are not very big, but the buildings which are comes within that process industry, like substations, control rooms, laboratories, maintenance workshops, even the sometimes even the administration buildings are designed by this civil engineer. So that civil engineer looks after all aspects of civil engineering in a process industries. There are no separate structural engineers and there are no separate environmental engineers employed by this big consultant. And therefore, those who want to go in EPC, instead of EPC, I will say a process industries specialization, then they have to develop their faculties in all these subjects.
So they should be all in one type of engineers.
Yes.
Even the underground drainage system design, it requires knowledge of hydraulics, all these Manning's formula and all. Everything is required when you are working in a process industry as a civil engineer. So what is generally a selection criteria? Mr. Kalbag, you must have taken interviews for so many, you must have been in the selection process of for civil engineering people for the department. What is generally required? What is the selection criteria? Do they have to have a PhD or MTech or?
Basically, selection criteria is the strong foundation in the engineering. And generally what happens, because in process industry, now you are doing all different type of designs. I'm describing only the design part of process industry. I will come to the other two aspects afterwards. So basically when we are employing the people in the design field, for the process industry, we see that he is very strong in structural engineering first. But that forms more than 50% of the design work consists of the structural engineering in a process industry. And the structures are not very simple like a residential building. For example, in a residential building design, people do this, if you are familiar with STAD or ETAP, the software, there are load cases you have to give before software really comes out with a design. These are generally the primary load cases and combination of load cases. And these are totally about 32 numbers.
Yeah. And generally mostly dead load and live load, imposed load.
Composite. But when you come to the process industries, apart from these 32 cases, there are special cases which are applicable to the process industries, and that total number goes sometimes 55-60 load combinations are to be worked out.
And since it is a multidisciplinary industry, you will have to take loads from piping, mechanical, electrical instrumentation. So it's not only dead load and imposed load, live load, but so many other loads are there.
Other loads are to be taken into account. And when you are taking the wind load in a building design, you take the wind load, total wind load on the structure as specified by 875, ISA 875. But when in a process industry, what happens is basically the wind will come when the construction is going on. Because construction takes more time, and construction is going on, and it is an open type of structures. And there will be wind loads on the equipment, wind load on the piping, wind load of other facilities. And you have to take into account when the total dead load is not there. And therefore, that dead load doesn't balance the wind load. And that case is also is to be considered as one of the cases when half the construction is done.
So when the vertically downward load is less and horizontal
load is more
due to wind. Yeah.
So this type of special cases which people learn, that this type of cases you may not learn in colleges. None of the colleges will teach you this thing. But when you come to the profession and start working with this EPC consultant, your senior will teach you that these are the special requirements of structural engineering which you have to take into account. So basically, the after that 50% of the structural engineering is involved, we see that he is very strong in structural engineering. Other aspects like road designs or environmental engineering, which generally is ETP design in process industry, that effluents, there are different type of effluents in process industries, which are called chemical sewers, oily sewers, fire water, then there are condensate water. There are many types of effluents which are to be taken into account. How they generate and how they are transported to the final destination, how they are treated, what are the civil facilities required to treat. All these things are necessary, and I do not think these will be taught in your colleges. None of the colleges will teach you this thing. But that you will learn once you start working with this consultant.
So it is not only structural know-how, but ability to interact with various disciplines and pick up the right data which is required for your design. That quality also is required.
Yeah.
Interaction with multidisciplinary engineers.
Yes, multidisciplinary engineering is required, because the civil engineers, suppose he is designing a substation. A civil engineer is designing a substation, so he does architectural as well as structural engineering. So he should know what are the requirements of the electrical engineer, what he is going to do, how many panels he is going to put, how the panels will be put, how the panels will be operated, how the cables will come inside the panel and how the cables will go outside the panel. All these things should be known to civil engineer, then only he can design a substation which fits into requirements of that process industry. So this is a multi-discipline. You don't be afraid of anything. All these things you learn only when you start working. It is not possible to learn these things when you
so
are a student.
So it's on-job training.
It is a on-job training. And every consultant, when they employ fresh engineers, they have 1 year or 2 years of training before they really start signing on the documents. So you are not afraid. Don't be afraid of
so basically you feel, as I asked in the beginning of this, all this doctorate, PhD and MTech and all that is not much necessary. One can pick up
I will elaborate slightly on this. What has happened, when we started the engineering at that time, there were very few postgraduates classes available, facilities available, few in IITs. At that time only 5 IITs were there, only 5 IITs, and some very well-known institute like VizitAI only have had this MTech. And at that time the software designs were basically, PCs were invented much afterwards. Even the computers were not there. When I started, only one computer which was available in Bombay was in IIT, and that also of a very small capacity. Okay, the most of the complicated designs were not even done here. I remember I had to go to the Chennai IIT for doing a particular design, which was basically a dynamic design, and none of the computers in Bombay was able to do that. So that was the time when people only B-Tech or E people were involved or chosen for the design work. But now what has happened was the with the progress and the development in the computer section and the applications, the designs code, every revision of the code becomes more and more complicated than the earlier one, and it involves more and more structural engineering to be done. And for that, I advise that if you want to do for a structural make structural engineering as your career, you must do the post-graduation.
Okay.
Post-graduation, you must do it, because in process industry, for example, you have to do the compressor foundation for the compressors. Now these are huge compressors, very huge compressors, and that foundation design is very, very complicated. When we started the design, the computers were not there. We used to do the manual calculation, but when we did the manual calculation, dynamic calculation, but doing manually, there were so many aspects which were overlooked or even not known to us. But now with the development, we know exactly how it behaves, what are the points, weak points in that design, and this can be highlighted by your software, right? So to use that software itself, you require a very thorough knowledge of the dynamics of structures. And dynamics of structure, I think it's taught in post-graduation degrees and not in graduation degrees. And therefore it is necessary. Then even in a simple residential building design, nowadays people use ETAP software. And ETAP software is based basically on the newest technique of finite element analysis. That the finite element analysis, basically this technique started somewhere in 70s itself. So it is a very recent for the finite element technique to be used in structural engineering is a very recent development. But the software are available, and most of the people using the software who are not done post-graduation, but they use ETAP for structural engineering, use it blindly without knowing what are the limitations of that software and how it can be used, which is very dangerous. So you must know the finite element technique before you use ETAP software or any software which is based on the finite element analysis, because you should know what are the limitations of that, where you can use that software and where you cannot use that software. So these are the things, and therefore, and what has happened because of the development and more complications in the process itself, more and more complication in the codal requirements, it is but necessary that for a structural engineer who wants to go, whether it is in a residential buildings or in a process industry, you must do post-graduation, because this finite element technique, then plasticity, which is not taught in B-Tech level, are necessary.
And as you started the very good topic about computer literacy, so whether a junior engineer or an engineering student, during his academic years only, he should pick up few computer literacy, like he should learn few computer programs, or how it should be done, like. See, or it is taught during the on it is on job training. What do you feel? What are your views on this?
Okay. See, basically what has happened now, computers are basically daily part and parcel of our life. Okay. Whether it is engineering, whether it is the accounting, whether it is marketing, anything, or even in medicine, biotechnology. So everywhere without computer you cannot survive. Okay. Now what application you will use on those computers is your choice. As far as structural engineering is concerned, these softwares are very complicated softwares, very high, it requires very, when they are developed, they use very high algorithms, okay? And to know and handle it very efficiently, you must know the computer. And you cannot do away with the computers when you come to the fields. Any field you take, any field you want to go, you will have to go. If you want to become a planning engineer, then also your computer is necessary, because there are software like Project
Primavera,
which is a very, very comprehensive software. And
nowadays they have introduced Primavera in the curriculum.
Yes, it must be.
It is there.
Yeah. Earlier we used to do only CPM PERT. And we used to do the planning, but now it is not possible. Without
so what are the, basically coming back to our focus, like our process industry, which softwares or which programs from Microsoft Office, or which are the important softwares one should try to learn as and when he gets time during academic career, during academic years, or as soon as he passes out? Which important softwares are there?
There are certain basic softwares you must learn. I mean, without that you cannot enter. It's basically the AutoCAD you have to do, which is a drawing software. I will tell you why it is to be necessary. You will say the draftsman does the drafting, why I should use it? Another 10 years and there will not be draftsman in any engineering college, any engineering offices, okay? The engineer will do the drafting himself. Because there are comprehensive softwares which are available, which starts from the drawing to the final of the fabrication drawings. One link, one software. So for that you will require the basic knowledge of AutoCAD. Then in designing, there are many, many very good softwares available. One is the STAT Pro. STAT is the basic. There, when the version comes, they go on changing the extension. That is STAT 3, earlier it was there, now it is called STAT Pro. Then you have GT Strudel, then you have SAP 2000, then you have ETAP. So there are many things which are does the structural analysis and design.
And for then, calculations,
then you know there are Excel program which is a part of basically Microsoft Office. That is a necessity. You must every student should know Excel. It is the
Microsoft
most
Excel,
interesting,
yeah.
most fun. It is a fun to use that, yeah. Excel sheet. So Excel you must know. Then if you want to become a planning engineer, definitely I told you Primavera is one software you must know. Then in geotechs there are many softwares which I am not very familiar, because I am not a geotechnical expert, but there are available, okay, for particularly for the calculation of stability of slopes, they are available. Then
for fabrication, Revit, and
for fabrication, there are fabrication like StruCAD is one. Then Xsteel is one. Now Xsteel is becoming very, very popular. Xsteel is one. Then process industry, there is one very special software which is used by multidiscipline. Is PDS.
It's a 3D modeling. Basically.
It is a 3D modeling, and on that model, every engineer, a structural engineer, puts his columns, beams, slab. The mechanical engineer puts his equipment. The piping people puts the his piping. Electrical people puts the electrical trays. that instrument people puts their instrument trays and instrument cables. So all this in one single model, everything is included, PDS. Now that the PDS, basically all engineers are not, they do not use regularly. Basically, it is done by the PDS group. It is a special
modelers.
Group, modelers, they do it. But review of that is to be done by the engineer. And unless you know preliminary things about PDS, you will not be able to do the review of that PDS.
So basically, for the large process industries, which are large plants, the clashes, the whether any piping, any pipe or mechanical equipment or civil structure is clashing with each other, that is very well understood before construction. It is highlighted very well in the models, model review. So it is very helpful. So students should note that it is not only 2D drawings, AutoCAD drawings, where the industry is using. Nowadays, industry has gone much, much ahead. And 3D modeling is come into the picture. Client is insisting that their project should be done in the 3D model. Apart from PDS, PDMS, SP3D, these are also software used for modeling, 3D modeling. And as Mr. Kalbag said, that a civil engineer need not know this modeling. There are people, separate modelers for it, but you should be able to review it. You should be able to check this model, whether any fouling or clashes are there. Many times underground clashes and underground foulings between the pipes, underground pipes and footings are also there. Sometimes because of this fouling, civil engineers require to redesign, resize their footings. So all these things are new trends in this industry, and students should know about it.
Yeah. So these are the software. So my advice to you students are, basically you must know the Microsoft Office, at least Excel and Word. Then you should know at least one design software, that is STAT Pro. If you learn STAT Pro, it is good. If you learn eType, it is still good. Okay. So at least these two, forget about GT Strudel, SAP 2000. Then there are another one. There is one more, I don't remember.
Yeah.
But many, rarely use software. There are many softwares, but at least which are very popular are STAT Pro and ETAP. ETAP is thoroughly used in 95% cases in commercial and residential buildings.
And these are all internationally
RCC consult.
Used.
Yes, internationally
they are
used.
Not only in India.
These are internationally used ETAPs, and basically it's a STAT Pro. If you know this, there are classes which are conducted by the authorized agents of these companies. The STAT Pro comes from a company called Bentley. So they have the basically authorized people to conduct the classes, and they regularly conduct the classes. You must attend. Those people who want to become a designer, structural designer, you must learn this at the student level.
Yeah,
and it is very, very easy, and it is very, very interesting.
Yeah, and I would like to add few points in this. Nowadays, this Bentley, the company which is propagating these softwares like STAT Pro, they have students version. It is freely available, and it is nowadays they are installing this students version in many of the engineering institutes. Many civil engineering colleges have this STAT Pro installed, students version installed in their computer labs. So do contact your colleges and do check whether such facility is there in your own college. If it is there, you should try to learn it when while you're during your vacations or during your academic years only. So it will be certainly very useful in the long run in your careers. So it is freely available. Do remember that.
Yeah. Then after software, the familiarity with the Indian standard specification and codes. The specification means basically it specifies which are the quality, which are the parameters a particular object or particular item should have. It specifies. like cement, if you take, then there is a specification, Indian specification, which says the grade 53 cement shall have, and it gives the different chemical composition, it gives what is the size of the particle it should have, and there are other test criteria also it gives. So basically that specification, those specification you must at least read. You may not be very familiar with this. As a student, you are not expected to know all the codes and all this parameter. But at least, just like you read a novel, you read codes, which are very basic codes. Like if a structural engineer, read IS 456. And IS 800 for the structural steel, IS 456 is for the RCC design. Just read these two codes like a, just like a novel. Okay, you are not expected to know each and every clauses of that. It is not necessary also. But when you read these codes, you will understand the theoretical part of the structural engineering. Because when you do try to learn structural engineering, it is a theoretical thing, okay? And all people may not like the theoretical thing. People may think it's a boring thing. But when you start reading the code, which are the applicable part of the structural engineering, it becomes very interesting. And then you will know why in structural engineering that thing is to be done. So that you can use this in application of this code. So this reasoning, when you know and you try to connect the clauses of these IS codes with the theoretical part of the structural engineering, it becomes very interesting. So you must read these two codes at least, those people who want to go for a structural engineering as their career. Similarly, there are other codes which codes and specifications where people want to go in different lines for road those people who want to go for highways design all that time. The specification which are published by the central government, which are called Ministry of Road and Highways, MORTH specifications, are the excellent specification. Very handy, very useful, very detailed specification. All over the country, those MORTH specifications are used to prepare very good roads and highways. So these are the people you should first decide which line you want to take. And if you, once you decide that, then please go through these codes, IS codes. You will have more and more knowledge, and your employability will increase if you know the codes. May not be thoroughly, but at least the outline of that.
Even IS 875 for various loadings.
IS 875, you may be already knowing the various there are live loads, dead loads, wind loads. These are specified in 875, and earthquake load is done in 1893. Okay, so basically these codes, you just read it.
Very, very valuable advice Mr. Kalbag has given. Now, Mr. Kalbag, you were talking about process industry. Not necessarily all projects will always be coming for design which are on the Indian land, like the sites are in India. Many times, these companies must be getting projects for designing which are outside India, in maybe in USA or Gulf or in Canada. So what about these country standards? I suppose they must be requiring to use US codes or British codes when the projects are abroad.
Basically what happens is at a student level, it is very difficult to learn the codes of the different countries. But if you are familiar with the code of one country, then it is very easy to learn the code of the other countries, because more or less the principle remains same, whether it is an Indian code, American code, or British code. What really makes the difference is the finer points, the depth to which they go in detailing a particular thing makes the difference. American codes are very fine, and design is much deeper. Requirements are much more than IS code. IS codes to that extent are still not developed. Though recently there is a trend that IS code to bring to the international level. But there are still some time, probably another 20 years, 25 years, Indian standard codes will also be matching with the European codes or the American codes.
So basically, Mr. Kalbag, for working in this industry, one should, the qualities required in a civil engineer, he should be able to adapt to different countries' codes also. You never know, he may require to work one fine day in Saudi codes or Euro codes or German codes, any codes, right?
Right. So basically what happens, as I said, it may not be possible when you are a student to learn the codes of the different countries, because basically you may not be even familiar with the Indian codes. So basically if you are familiar with the Indian code, it becomes very easy to follow any other codes, because only clauses, depth or the detailing matters, because the principle remains same, whether whatever is the code, it remains same. If seismic forces to be registered by the structure, whether it is designed by 1893 or it is designed by the American code ASCE, is it remains same, it doesn't make any difference. Much difference. Only they will say you do use these parameters, and Indian code says you use these parameters. Only these small parameters will be different from here to there, but it doesn't make any much difference. So I don't advise at this stage, when you are a student, you should try to learn foreign codes. It may not be possible, it may be too much. So if you are familiar with the Indian codes, it should
job,
suffice.
It is when not you very come, difficult.
Yes, when you go, start working, it is not difficult. Not difficult at all. It is a question of reading the American code for 10-15 days, and you will be familiar with that if you are thorough with the Indian code.
So very well explained about what is EPC industry and all. Now about the work culture, what is a typical office work atmosphere, and what are the working hours? We hear about a lot of overtimes and leave cancellations, and so what is, how hectic is this profile or this this kind of job?
Basically what happens when you are talking about this process industry consultant's office, then the timings are defined. They may be 9 to 5:30, 9 to 6 or 9:30 to 6 o'clock, something like that. But when you are engineer and you have been given a job, and that job is to be finished in a particular time, then whether it is a 6 o'clock in the evening or 5 o'clock in the evening doesn't make any difference. You yourself decide that I have to extend today or sit for another 2 hours to complete that job, because you are supposed to issue the drawings which are based on your design work. Because your construction manager is waiting for that drawing, and he cannot postpone any activity at site because thousands of people are working there. So one day delay is a basically a blot on your career, and that blot on your career is not given by your supervisor. You yourself feel that I failed today in issuing the drawing. I'm telling you, I'm 46 years, I always assured my construction manager that there will not be hold for a single day. I will do whatever but I will see that not a single day there will be hold, because the drawings are not available. I will come to site and give you hand sketches, and I will see that the job proceeds. So that assurance you must give it to your construction manager, and for that if you have to put a few hours late in the office, you will have to work, and that nobody will tell you, no supervisor, no boss will tell you wait today. That I can assure you in any consultancy.
It's your own responsibility.
It is yourself you will decide that today I have to wait, I will do it and I will go, because that is the responsibility given to you. And when you design, you know that is your own baby. Just like you love your child at home, it is the you love your that design, because you are the man who gives the birth to that structure.
Yeah, it is so nice.
And you love it.
Yeah. And about nowadays, these students also ask, like in software field and in finance field, there is this work from home option is becoming very common. But looking at this multidisciplinary work profile, job description in this process industry, what do you feel about work from home options? I don't think there is.
I do not think that basically this type of process industry will ever allow work from office. It has not happened up till now, at least.
Work from home.
No, because it is a multidisciplinary. You require day to day, you have to talk to your piping engineer or a construction manager or a mechanical engineer or a procurement guy, and that cannot be done by sitting in an office. Every day you have to
Even
talk to them, and you have
3D model on a server. Which is in the office, right?
Yes, and it is a multidisciplinary, so basically that coordination is required day to day, and for that it is a teamwork, and for that teamwork you are supposed to be in that office. As far as the building, residential building design is concerned, probably somebody may be able to work from the site, because the coordination is only with the architect. No other discipline is involved in that, and at that time probably you will be. But then what happens? Your home becomes your office, and you work from your home. You are working from your office itself. So that possibility is there, but I don't think in your process industry it is possible. Up till now, at least, it has not happened. Even in states where that work from home is a routine in other fields, but not in process industry.
Now, naturally, next question is going to come, like we came to know about, we understood what is EPC industry, we came to know about what is process industry and the work culture and the responsibilities and the work hours. How good is this field for lady engineers? Because nowadays, olden days, very few girls used to be there in civil engineering classes in colleges. But nowadays, it is almost 50-50. Ladies are not lagging behind in any field. So how suitable is this job for ladies? What is your opinion on this?
Process industry discipline or process industry field is open for ladies, and there is no innovation. There are no restriction for lady to work in any field of engineering, procurement or construction. And people do work. Previously, ladies were working only in design office. Some were working in procurement office, this thing. But nowadays, ladies started working in construction. They work as inspectors. They work at construction engineers. There's no problem, no innovation, no restrictions nowadays.
So that's a very good encouraging statement he has made for girls also. Now, about next obvious question, how good are the salaries, and what about salaries, perks, promotions in this field? What is general, like compared to some other civil engineering fields like site jobs or teaching jobs, what are the scales in this industry?
So basically, in process consultant who are working in process industry, they are generally are multinational companies. They have established their offices in Bombay, Chennai, Noida. Basically, at these three places, they are in majority. Then there are few people in Baroda, Pune, but not to that extent. But there's a major industry is Bombay, Chennai and Gurugram. Okay. I'm talking about the process industries, not IT. IT is different in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Pune. And these multinational salary levels are more or less everywhere in all the countries, more or less are same, similar. And they are quite good. it will make life comfortable for the people who work at different levels. Okay, the salary etc. may not be as good as the what you will get if you go to Gulf countries and start working there as a construction. No, there is no comparison with that. If you are looking for that type of a money, then you have to go to Gulf countries. But the Gulf countries, what has happened now, the pace of development has come down substantially there, and the employment facilities are not as much as they were earlier. So that you have to take into account, okay? And there are some EPC consultants even in Gulf countries, branch offices of these multinational companies, but they do not recruit raw engineers, okay? They recruit experienced engineers because they don't have that training system, etc. They want man to start from the next day, and therefore it is necessary that you must have at least 4-5 years experience if you want to go to even to Gulf countries as a design expert. Then you must learn tricks of the trade 4-5 years in multinational companies in India. And perks, salaries, working hours are very comfortable, and they are very respected in the society, and there is no hassle because you are working with the people who are having same type of intellectual levels as you have. So basically is very comfortable to work with this type of company.
So apart from very nicely spelled Mr. Kalbag, but apart from you said one can go and get job opportunities abroad, what about like travel abroad opportunities while working in such industry, like working in India, employed in India, but do they get exposure to travel around the world for
yeah,
for projects and for meetings and sites?
Yes, what happens is because these companies are multinational companies and they do the project all over the world, for reducing the their cost, they offload those design work in Indian offices, okay? And Indian engineers get involved in designing the project in foreign countries. And there is a coordination required between these two offices, their foreign office. They may say right in the beginning that 30% of the work will be done in their foreign office and 70% work will be done in Indian offices. Then there is a requirement that a coordination and proper handing over of that work from there to Bombay or India happens. And for that, the Indian engineers go to their foreign office. They stay there for a few months, work on that project, get involved in that project, know what is required, what is not required, and then they bring that work to India and do the Indian work. So there are many opportunities, and it is a very routine for people to go abroad to work in their foreign offices in these multinational companies, EPC companies.
So this is certainly perks like global opportunities. And while you were telling us about global opportunities, it came in my mind that amongst work hours, maybe extended work hours must be happening because of these international projects. Like when it's time to close Indian office, like 5 p.m. in India, maybe that is the time when the U.S. offices are opening. So if you are working on U.S. projects, American projects, maybe the telephone calls, telecons and discussions may be happening after our working hours. So we are just giving idea to what is the working culture in this industry. So this point came in my mind. What would you like to say about it?
What happens basically, particularly with the U.S., if job is unloaded from the U.S. office and you have to coordinate with that, then this problem comes. In Europe, this problem is not there because they are 4.5 years hours or 5.5 hours behind. It doesn't make any difference. But in U.S., which is about 10.5 hours to 12.5 hours behind us, then there is a problem. So what is done is right in the beginning it is decided that they will sit late in their office and we will be early in the office. So we reach office at 8 o'clock instead of 9 o'clock or 9:30. Those days are decided. That is, let us say 2 days in a week or 1 day in a week, it is decided that we should go early, 8 o'clock. And they will stay late there in their office and the communication takes place. Because communication nowadays happens only through email. Your 90% of the communication is through the email. But still there will be 10% of the communication which is essentially is to be done in person. And nowadays mostly it is done through video conferencing. And for that, it is very easy. It is not very strenuous. One day in a week, and predetermined also, so you can plan your activities very well. And that particular day, you have to be there early in the office, and they have to stay late in their office, and it is taken care of. I don't think it is a very routine affair in any multinational companies, and nobody is bothered about that.
And brings out one important point students must note, like especially our Indians, junior engineers and students from rural or small town areas, mostly their studies are done in vernacular medium. And when you must have noticed, when we were talking about, Mr. Kalbag was talking about interacting with international engineers, you must develop a habit of talking in English. Understanding English and answering in English, isn't it, Mr. Kalbag?
See, basically what happens when you go for an interview, if you have the mastery over the language, then you impress the people and you may stand a better chance than others having the same capability. But my experience shows that just because some people are weak in English, they will not get job. It has not happened. At least I have not done that. I have recruited people who could not speak proper language. I have recruited them because they were very good in structures.
Okay.
So I don't think, like me, other people also probably doing the same thing. If they are good in their subject, definitely they will be recruited. But definitely You have to improve your language as you grow up in the organization. Then that language, mastery over the language is an essential thing. Because otherwise you will not go up. You may get the employment, but you may stagnate at a particular level. If you want to go up and up, then you must master the language. Apart from talking to foreign people when you are doing the foreign jobs, even in your own organization, to better your chances for promotion, you must have a mastery over your language.
Now, one more common question comes in the mind because people are seeing around nowadays. This layoff word is becoming very common. People are hearing more often about it, especially in these multinational companies or process industry. And some parents ask us, like, why should we encourage our children to join such industry instead of that? This government jobs are very peaceful. One will join as a trainee and then come out directly when he's retired. There are not very less chances of layoff in government jobs. So what views you have on this?
So basically, it is a mentality, okay? As I know, and I have experience of this 46 years working in this field, there were very, very few occasions where the multinationals have laid their stuff. Because they are doing the work all over the world. If work is not there in India, there is a work in US. If there is no work in US, the work will be in Gulf countries. If Gulf countries is not there, it is in Far East. So they are hunting for the job all over the world. And then they know that Indian office have less workload. Then they dump that work on Indian offices and get it done through Indian offices. So very few cases that laid off is alone. And second thing, when a one company, multinational company, suppose it does the layoff, there are other 10 companies to recruit you. If you have a good experience, they will call you, give you better emolument than what you were earning in that company, and they will employ you. So you need not bother about that. The laying off has not happened, or nobody has suffered. I knew people in this field for many, many years, and I have not seen a single person who suffered because he was laid off in any company. It has not happened. If somebody says, no, I'm happy, I'm from a rural area, and my mentality is to work in that particular environment, then government jobs are also good. I'm not saying government nowadays pays better, and their retirement benefits are much better than the private companies, most of the private companies. So it is basically what you want. You have to choose whether you want a challenging role in your profession, or you want to be happy with what you get. Emoluments are good, promotions are regular, retirement benefits are okay, you are staying with in your own environment. If you think government jobs are good, it's okay, perfectly okay. And governments are also doing large projects, not like a private company. They are also dealing with the large projects, and all these aspects which I have described in EPC will happen even in government. So there should not be any inhibition in working with the government offices. It is your choice. It is your mentality.
So very, very informative discussion we had, chat we had with Mr. Kalbag. All his 46 years of experience, he actually could guide, I think, our newcomers, new civil engineers, budding engineers so well. I'm sure they will benefit from his discussion, and I really would like to thank Mr. Kalbag. But before thanking, do you want to say anything, some particular message to students? Do you recommend this process industry field? Like you spelt both plus and minus points, the risk, the responsibilities, the working hours, etc., etc. So according to you, your personal opinion, do you recommend this field to budding engineers?
Yeah, I recommend any field, not for process. Process, definitely, it is very good for people who take interest in the activity which I described earlier. It is a very good field, very interesting field. But like this process industry, other fields also are very good, like nuclear, for somebody wants to go in a nuclear, or somebody goes for an offshore exploration, like crude extracted from the North Sea, or a year in Bombay High. So it is possible. So it is not a question of this field or that field. Wherever you want to take interest, work hard, party hard, not hardly. Because basically it is not only working, okay? After all, it is your life. You have to enjoy your life. 5 days you work very hard with concentration, okay? And then to remove that fatigue, to make your life very enjoyable, to spend your time, you have to do party, okay? Go play game, go to the club, go for swimming, go for hiking, go for in a pub and have a drink, or go for a movie, enjoy the life, okay? It's not a burden, work is not a burden. Okay, so work is a social activity. Like any other social activity, it is a social activity. You have friends outside, you have friends inside the office also. So all you are within your friend circle. Okay, so life is enjoyable.
Such a valuable advice we got from Mr. Kalbag. I thank from my bottom of heart, from me and also from my listeners, my subscribers, that very, very valuable chat we had, with informative, very informative chat with Mr. Kalbag. So students, this is end of this session, and please subscribe to my channel. Please share it with your colleagues and friends. Do press the button, press the bell icon on the right side, so you'll get all the notifications as and when I start uploading new videos. Also, there is a comment box below. Do write your positive comments in the comment box below, and you can, if you want, you can ask some question. Very specific question, should be very specific, to the point, preferably one line only. Don't write essay, and we will try to cover answers to that question in our next interviews. So bye to you, and best wishes to you, from Chatlog with Civil Engineers. Bye.